So I want to get into the message, and you know, we're in a series and called Revival, your series Revival. And I kind of like when Pastor Ruben and Jessica sent me the sermon series, and man, let's give it up for Jess, man. She is like, man, on fire. She's making things happen and moving. So the sermon series is on revival, but I wanted to kind of like change a little bit to revival. And so we all need to be revived, you know, and because when you think about revival, you think about the church, you think about a revival Sunday meeting. You know, I don't know about y'all, but growing up in the black church, revivals used to last from sun up to sundown. Then it would be like 20 days long, and you have about three people up under the tent, but they called it a revival, right? And so, but we revival. And so I wanted to talk about revival, and my topic of my subject today is called Running on Empty. Running on empty. And so here in 1 Corinthians, the theme verse I want to use, it says, we are pressed on every side and by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we get back up. That's not what the word, that's my version. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. We like that weeble wobble, that we don't fall down. Weeble wobble fall. I'm dating myself. Weeble wobble fall, but they don't stay down. She's shaking her head on. She's like, I know what you're saying, Pastor Mike. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word today. We thank you, Lord, that you will continue to bless us through this word, that, Lord, that after this word, we would never, ever be the same again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on, you turn around as you're sitting down and tell your neighbor, hey, man, you know what? You look good. Come on, tell me you look good. But you don't look as good as Pastor Mike. Come on. What's up, my man? And so when we're talking about running empty, we're talking about we press, you know. And so Paul was talking about we're pressed on every side and that there's troubles, that we all deal with some type of troubles. We all have some things that we deal with. We all come up against troubles. And I don't care what walk of life that you come from. I don't care how much is in your bank account, how much is not in your bank account. I don't care if your status is low, your status is high in life. At the end of the day, trouble will visit your front door. Amen, somebody. Amen. Trouble will have a way of finding you, and really it kind of like find you at the peak of when things are happening. When you think everything is running smooth, that's when troubles have a way of coming at your door. And so what happens is that when we're running on empty, we really are pressured, or we really do things that really we wouldn't do if we weren't tired. So I'm going to give you five common signs that you are tired. Five common signs that you are tired or that you're feeling empty. Number one is this, is that lack of focus. When you have lack of focus, when you can't focus, when you're not able to pay attention to what you're doing, you start one thing, then you move into another thing, or you find that you can't focus at work, or you can't focus at school, or you can't focus in, you may be sitting here right now, you can't even focus on this message, because at the end of the day, if you're feeling tired, you will have lack of focus. And number two, you become irritable. When you're tired, you become irritable. Anybody in here, when you're tired, you become like a bulldog. Anybody, ain't nobody gonna admit it right now. My man back there looking at me, he said, yes, I do, right? And so at the end of the day, when you're tired, you become irritable. You know, I can tell when I'm tired because I become irritable, and I can't stand nobody. I don't want to be around nobody. When I'm tired, you don't want to be around me, because especially if I'm around you a lot. I ain't talking about my wife. I'm talking about even in my workforce. Even like, all right, let me be real with you. Even at church. Come on, somebody. You think that we love you all the time? Sometimes I don't love you, because at the end of the day, I mean, I love you, but I don't love who you are at that moment, right? Because I become irritable, and I don't want to be around you. So, I mean, even at church, I mean, on staff, you know, there's times, man, that, you know, I come home and tell my wife, honey, I know it's time for me to take a break. She said, why? I said, because I can't stand them, you know? And so I know at that time it's time to take a break. And then your physical health. And then when you find out that your physical health is breaking down, and you're having a lot of illness, a lot of sickness, that means that you need to focus in on your tiredness or you being running on empty, and then feeling anxious. You know, when you start feeling anxious and you find yourself antsy and you know, you find yourself nervous about certain things, that's when you know that you're running on empty. And lastly, when you're hard to get along with. Wow. Somebody said, wow. Somebody in this room right now is hard to get along with. You can't nobody talk to you. Can't nobody tell you the sun is shining. They can't tell you that it's raining. You know, no matter what they say to you, you got an attitude, you're snapping back, you know, with two fingers in a snap. You know, you know, at the end of the day, your thing is that you're just hard to get along with. And it's not because that's your character, that's because you're tired. It's because you're tired. And so when you are tired, even your faith get tested. When you're tired, even your faith get tested, your spiritual awareness becomes questionable. So Your faith get tested, your spiritual awareness become questionable, you feel like you're a boxer swinging in the air at the enemy, and the enemy is ducking and dodging every swing that you're throwing at them, but at the end of the day, you're losing your strength at a fight you can't win because you're tired. And when you are tired, man, you find yourself in pressure situations. So what does the Bible say about rest? This is what it says in Genesis 2:2-3. It says, by the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy because on it, he rested from all the work of creating that he has done. And so even Jesus, the Father, knew that it was time to take rest. He knew the rest. So after 7 days of working 6 days, on the seventh day, he took a rest. So that means that, you know, some of us, we work 6-7 days a week. We work 80 hours, maybe 90 hours. We work in overtime because, man, I got to grab all that overtime, man, because I need to get that money. And let me tell you something. It's not always about the money, but it's about your mental awareness and about your health. At the end of the day, when you find yourself chasing money, money can never catch up with you. And so the thing is that when you're overworking, you have to rest. And I'm not saying you have to rest. The Bible says that on the seventh day, Jesus did what? He did what? He rest. Come on, say it. He did what? He rest. Yes, so he rests. And so have any one of you ever been tired of being tired? Just tired of being tired. Find yourself tired, man. I mean, you can't get up out the bed. You're sluggish. You know, you go to sleep. You really can't sleep because you're wrestling about tomorrow. You're wrestling about your bills. You're wrestling about, you know, dealing with this old crazy COVID or whatever's going on in this world. You're dealing, you know, so what happens? You fall asleep, but you wake back up because you're tired and you can't sleep. Isn't that amazing that you're tired and you can't even sleep? Because you're restless, and when you're restless, you can't relax when you're restless. And so you can't sleep. And so what happens is that you become tired of being tired. So let me tell you what you got to do. Number one, you must break before you break. You must break before you break. All right, I'm going to break that down. So I'm going to break that down, right? You must break before you break. That means you got to take a break before you break. That means before you break and go off on somebody, you need to take a break. That means that before you find yourself losing your head and saying things you know you shouldn't say and hurting people's feelings, you need to take a what? A break. You need. So my wife and I, we do Marriage Monday every Monday night, and this is a plug. Yes, it is. Watch Marriage Monday. If you guys are married and you're trying to grow your marriage, every Monday night on Facebook and Instagram at 8 p.m., we do what we call Marriage Monday. And we talked last week a lesson on pause, hitting the pause button. And so what we were talking about is that when you find yourself in a heated situation, you're about to say some things you have no business saying, you want to hit the pause button. And we gave you ways on how to hit the pause button. So go back and check that out and then join us tomorrow night at 8 p.m. I'm going to be looking for y'all, too. Y'all better be on there, right? And so what happens, it says, this is what it says in Matthew 11:28-30. It says, come unto me, all who are struggling hard and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. And it says, put on my yoke and learn from me. I'm gentle and humbled, easy to bear, and my burden is light. So Jesus says, come unto me. The yoke that you carry is heavy. The things that you're carrying every single day is heavy, but I'm going to give you rest. Because why? Because my yoke is easy. So the thing that the world put on you, I'm not going to put the same thing on you. I'm going to take everything the world take off of you, and I'm going to put this light, easy yoke upon you. And then it goes on here. It says in Lalia, I think that's how you say her name. Here's her quote. She says this. She says, you recreate yourself when you relax. You recreate yourself when you relax. Quote here from MCH. I don't know who that is, but this great scholar said, that's my initials if you didn't catch that, but all the good, that just went right over y'all head. All the good stuff is on the other side of tiredness. All the good stuff is on the other side of tiredness. What are you trying to say here, Pastor Mike? Well, think about it. And I always use this. I said, just think about it. You have a set of keys, and you're trying to unlock a particular door. You're trying to do something with your keys, but that key don't fit. Then what you do, you use another key. You take another key ring, and so because I have a few keys on my ring, you know, for the office, my home, and stuff like that. And so you put a key in, that key don't work. What do? You try another key, and all the keys look the same, but that particular key just don't open. So what happens is that what happens with us in life, we're constantly trying to open up situations. We're trying to constantly open up different type of doors, but the key is not fitting. But what I come to tell you this morning, that if you just hold on, that last key on your key ring is the key that's going to open up. But what happens is that you get so tired, you stop using your keys to open up what God has for you. And so understand this, that all the good stuff, it's on the other side of tired. Right when you're about to give up, God has the good stuff for you. Come on, are y'all with me so far? So God has the good stuff for you right on the other side of tiredness. And then it says here, your breakthrough is the last key on your key ring. Your breakthrough is the last key on your key ring. So number two, this is what else you got to do. When you're tired, when you're running on empty, you got to check who you're listening to. You got to be careful of who you are listening to. And as I thought about that, you got to be careful to what you're listening to. So you when you're tired, you're running on empty, you know, if you're tired running on empty, you need to make sure you got worship music on. And I'm just being real, because at the end of the day, if you got R. Kelly on and you're tired, you won't see nothing wrong. And some of the other older people looking at me like, what the heck is he? But all of them know, they like, that's my jam. So check who you are listening to. It says here in Matthew 4:5-10, it says this. It says, then Satan took him to Jerusalem to the roof of the temple. Jump off, he said. This is Satan talking to Jesus. He said, jump off and prove you are the Son of God. For the scriptures declare God will send his angels to keep you from harm. Isn't that just like the devil, man? You know, that devil coming up speaking lies into your ears and telling you things that you know ain't real. And then he goes on to say, they will prevent you from smashing on the rocks below. And Jesus looked at him like, Satan, really? Don, it also says not to put the Lord your God to a foolish test. And so don't let negative, this quote here, it says another quote by MCA. It says, don't let negative and toxic people rent space in your head, raise the rent, and kick them out. I'm going to say it again. Don't let negative and toxic people rent space in your head, raise the rent, and kick them out. So in other words, don't let toxic people speak things to you, even when you're tired or when you're not tired. At the end of the day, guess what? Satan has assigned haters to every one of us. He has his hater demons assigned to each and every one of you. And if you think that Satan loves you, he's here tricking you, because the devil hates us. And so he's going to always send someone or something to speak negativity to you. You know, that teacher that you grew up, when you was coming up as a kid, that teacher, you would never be nothing. You know, or you got that person who told you that, you know, you don't look good, or, you know, you don't look like the rest of them, or, you know, you got that person that you might have been in a rocky relationship that was a very physical or maybe a verbal abusive relationship, and they're telling you what you can be or what you never can be, and they're telling you that you never amount up to nothing. But I'm here to tell you that they're lying, because at the end of the day, we all are made in the image of God, and whenever you're attacking us, you're attacking what God has created. And what God has created, he has not created a mess. He has not created someone that's no good. He has not created someone that's not going to be nothing. He has created victorious people in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody, give God praise up in CWC this morning. So what happens is that when you're allowing people to talk negativity to you, that's their opportunity to drag you down. So number three, what you want to do, you want to check what and who you open your heart to. And so I just got a little short, quick illustration here. And so just think about, this is you to me. This is you. And Luke 11:24-25, it says this: when the evil spirit leaves a person, it goes into the desert and rests. So understand this. Even evil spirits need to rest. Even evil spirits get tired. So they have to rest. And so if they're going to rest, they got to find some place to what? Come on. Are you with me? Preach it with me. They got to find some place to what? Rest. Rest. And so it says here is that searching for rest. But when it finds none, it says, I will return to the person it came from. So it returns and find that former home swell. And so when you look at you, this is you, to me, and what it's saying here in this illustration is that when the house is swept, what happens, this is, just to say right here is maybe one thing that you're dealing with in life. This is you. Let me set this back up real quick. This is you here. Now what has happened, you were dealing with something. God delivered you from it, and he took it out of you. So that spirit that he took out of you, that demon or whatever that thing that was, that the word of God said that so easily beset you. I don't know what it may be. It may be alcohol. I don't know. I'm not here to judge what it is, because we all have something that God has taken out of us. Come on, somebody. We're not here as a judgmental church, but we all have God. You're sitting in this chair today because God found grace and mercy on your life. You're sitting here on a Sunday looking all good, man, and you have survived what has taken place. Because why? Because God have had grace and mercy on your life. You're sitting here today, you haven't lost your mind. You're sitting here today that you're not in the street. Why? Because God has found what? Grace and mercy on your life. And so what happens, the word of God says that he sweeps out. And so what happens, God cleans out the house. So now your house is clean. And so what happens is that once the house gets clean, it's so easy for us to get tired. And once you get tired, the word of God says this. It goes on and says, and when the evil spirit leaves a person, the spirits find seven what? Other what? Seven other what? Spirits. So he finds seven other spirits, and those seven other spirits are more evil than this one. And they enter the person and they live there. So you might have had this one particular thing that you dealt with, that God delivered you from. But now what's happening is that this particular spirit now, he doesn't come alone. He opens himself up, and he go and get his boys. So now what happens, you deal with the spirit of heartbreak. And so you're clean, but you went back to boo that you should never went back to. And now all of a sudden he broke your heart, or she broke your heart, and now your heart is being broken again. So, but this time, the heartbreak is a lot worse than it was the first time around. Why? Because you trusted them. You believed in them. They told you, I'm going to change. I'm not going to be the way I was. And then they come back and they're just as evil and nasty and just as cantankerous as they could be. And so now the heartbreak becomes more. And then what happens is that you find yourself, you know, you gave up drinking, but now you find yourself, it was okay, I had a couple of beers or I had a couple of glasses of wine, but I got cleared out of that. But what happened is that now this spirit says, oh, no, I'm going to make this worse off for you. This time around, it's going to be hard for you to shake. This time around, you're going to even end up with a drunk driver DUI. And so you're going to find yourself even now, you can't shake it because before you used to drink Modelo's. Now you're drinking Patron. So it becomes that much more. You were over the fact that you never compared anything against anybody, but now you have the spirit of jealousy. You become jealous of everything. You become jealous and you carry the spirit of jealousy, and no matter what anybody say to you, no matter how God is blessing you, you're never satisfied with what you have, because now what this spirit has done is went out and find other spirits to bring, and now you're carrying around the spirit of jealousy. And you never had, and you know what's so crazy about this, people, God? You never was jealous before, but because this spirit, because you have allowed this house to become clean and you went back to doing some of your old former things, this spirit found out, well, let me add something else back into this. I never was jealous before, but guess what? You are now. And so then what happened is you lose all ambitions to help everybody else and you become selfish. It's all about me. You never was like this before, but what happened? Your house got what? Clean. Come on, preach it with me. Your house got what?
Clean.
And you decided to go back to your old former ways. And this particular spirit said, you know what? You were able to get rid of me, but guess what? I got another spirit that's going to come. You got to deal with something else more. Why? Because you're tired. This is what happens when we get tired. So you got selfish ambitions. And then all of a sudden, you find yourself in fits of rage. You was never a person that carried rage. You was never a person that had the spirit of rage. But now you have fits of rage. And then what happens, you live an impure life and you find yourself falling into sexual sins. And so what happens, this particular spirit that you dealt with, that you got rid of, all of a sudden now, he comes back into your life with all his seven other spirits. All these seven other spirits, a total of eight spirits now, what has attacked your life, and all of a sudden now, this spirit that you got rid of has brought all this back into your life. This is what happens when we're tired. This is what happens when we let our guard down. You know, it says here in Romans 7:15, it says, for I do not understand my actions. I do not understand my actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. I do the very thing that I hate. Here's another quote that I have for you real quick before I end this. It says this, somewhere far down, there's an itch in our hearts. But you want to make it a point not to scratch it because you're unsure of what may come leaking out. Oh, let me break that down. Somewhere in this heart of ours, somewhere in this subconscious mind of ours, there's some things that we have buried. Come on. y'all know I'm telling the truth. Okay, Mike, there are some things that you have buried. There's some things that I know that I can't, places I know I can't go to. There's some people that I know I can't be around. There's some things that God has delivered me from or has removed me from that I know that I can't revisit that area because why? There's an itch that if I scratch it, it will come back to life. You know how you have a scab, and if you scratch it, it opens it back up? So you got to be very careful of not scratching that itch because you're unsure what may come leaking out. The house been clean. And so it says this in 1 Peter 5:8 and 9. It says, but self-control and alert. Being self-control and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around, roaring like a lion, looking for someone to devour him. So rest in him. We want to rest in God. And know that our house, through our resistance, because the word of God said, if you resist the devil, he's going to flee. And when, through our resistance, through prayer, through fasting, come on somebody, through accountability, through talking to someone, and through transparency, this is going to allow you to keep your house clean. This is allowing you to keep your house swept. And so when you find yourself in a state of tiredness and you find yourself in a state of being tired, know that the word of God says, put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against all the wiles of the devil. It didn't say, be perfect in everything that you do, because there's no perfect people in this room. There's no perfect people that's on this earth. But it says, put on the whole armor. And then when you read that scriptures out of Ephesians, it talks about the first thing it says is put on the helmet of what? Salvation. Why? Because the helmet of salvation is what protects your head. It protects your mind. It protects everything that you think. It protects everything, every decision that you make. And so in closing, the book of Matthew promises you that you are never alone. Even in your most down time, your most tired time, understand this, you are never alone. Confess your weariness to the Lord, and he will send you a comforter. If you're tired, confess your weariness to the Lord, and he will send you a comforter. The comforter doesn't change, doesn't always come in a form of a change, but in your circumstances, it can come as a form of peace. And when we're tired, we need peace. And sometimes peace is not changing your circumstances or your situations or your surroundings. Your peace is found in God. Come on, somebody. Your peace is found in God. Last scripture, Psalms 118:14. The Lord is my strength, and he's my song. The Lord is my strength, and he's your song. So right now, as we close out this message here, I don't know what you came in carrying. I don't know what you woke up with, what was going on before you walked through these doors, but I really sensed this morning that there are some people who are tired of being tired. You're just tired. And every right, I want to tell you this, don't be ashamed because you're tired. Because tiredness is not your character. It's not your identity. It's not who you are. It's just what happens to us all. And so if you're tired today, I just want you to just lift your hand and say, I just need peace. Come on, if that's you this morning, just lift your hand. Yes, come on, lift your hands all over this room. Yeah, leave your hands up. Come on, leave your hands up. This is me. Say, this is me. And you don't have to be, it's nothing weird about it. It's nothing weird about it. And it's nothing weird because God sent you this morning to hear this message. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is your opportunity to come to know him. And so for those who don't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, come on, I want you to lift your hand. If that's you, first of all, anybody here that say, I want to make Jesus the head of my life, come on. Thank God we all saved. We all saved. But once again, we're going to pray over everyone who's tired. We're going to pray that God give them peace and give them rest. But most of all, Lord, give them strength and give them hope. And know that God keep the house swept and clean.
Hey, thank you for watching. But why don't you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss a single video? By the way, why don't you share with your friends as well so they can enjoy these messages with you? Once again, thank you for watching. And every Sunday we're here. Join us live.